Our final presenter today is Loren Lerner, professor in the Department of Art History, a colleague of mine, a much loved one, who is, among other things, the editor of the Jerusalem Art History Journal, the product of undergraduate students who enthusiastically have studied with her in relation to images and ideas about Jerusalem over thousands of years. Dr. Lerner will this afternoon place the 67 Pavilion in Montreal within a panorama of international exposition fair narratives of Israeli nationhood that extends back to 1939-40, 70-year time period, which for her is a piece of cake in relation to a normal time frame of several thousand years. Thank you.
Was a renowned German Jewish art historian who settled in the United States in 1934 after the Nazis came to power. He wrote Studies in Iconology and Meaning in the Visual Arts, two canonic texts that are still at the core of art historical studies today. In these writings, he explains that art-related images are associated with concepts that originate in a worldview. With this in mind, the objective of this presentation is to consider the evolution of particular images relating to Israel's visual narrative of nationhood as found in the pavilions at three World's Fairs, New York City in 1939-40, Montreal in 1967, and Milan in 2015. The development of this visual narrative began with the Zionist art at the B'Tselem School of Arts and Crafts, founded in Jerusalem by the artist Boris Schatz. Schatz wanted to create an expression of national and spiritual independence that synthesized European artistic traditions and the local culture of the land of Israel. He proposed the idea to Zionist leader Theodor Herzl. And in 1906, 1 year after receiving funding, the B'Tselem School officially opened. It became the training ground for artists and craftsmen who would be tasked with designing a visual environment for the eventual Jewish state. In addition to their courses in drawing, painting, sculpture, and crafts, all students at B'Tselem studied Hebrew. This was more than a linguistic exercise. The revival of Hebrew became a central tenet of the ideology of Zionism. The artist of the letter was Zakov Stark, one of B'Tselem's original 10 students, who combined Art Nouveau designs with Islamic arabesques to create a distinctive calligraphy. This new Jewish art was decorative and strongly reminiscent of 19th century Orientalist paintings of biblical scenes. Religious motifs dominated, for example, description of holy places, scenes from the diaspora, and sayings from the Hebrew Bible. The images sought to make connections between the biblical period, the return to Zion from the Babylonian exile, the Hasmonean kingdom of Israel, and the Zionist aspirations for a Jewish state. They often combined Zionist symbols, such as the hands of the high priest raised in blessing, and the rising sun, which represented hope. From its beginning, a significant component of the B'Tselem School was the Nature Museum, whose purpose was to inspire the creation of a Hebrew style. Students spent considerable time drawing the specimens they found there. Schatz asked Israel Haroni, a zoologist, to teach Hebrew at the school But more importantly, Ahrani was put in charge of the museum's collections. One of his responsibilities was to gather different types of plants and animals and give them Hebrew names. A motif we often see in Bitzel's works is the palm tree, which is frequently described in the Bible. During this era, the Zionist establishment also encouraged photography. For example, in the same spirit that guided the Bitzel School, the Jewish National Fund commissioned photographs to spread the Zionist message. Artists such as Zoltan Kluger documented the Zionist enterprise, in particular the building of Jewish settlements, using photographic viewpoints and compositions that took their inspiration from Soviet art. Other photographers, such as Helmut Lursky, used light and angle to create portraits in a typical expressionist style. Taken in the 1930s, these pictures of pioneers, mainly laborers, chronicle the importance of creative labor, one of the themes of Jewish, Palestinian, Romantic, Socialist ideology. In 1939, Zionists seized the opportunity afforded by the New York World's Fair to promote a Jewish homeland in Palestine. They acted in concert with Jewish national aspirations that had been gaining strength in the shadow of the pogroms in Eastern Europe and the rise of Hitler and Nazism. The pavilion was an expression of Jewish political sovereignty, supported by aesthetic principles developed in Palestine in the first 30 years of the 20th century. These principles personalized Palestine as the Jewish homeland. The pavilion's visionary architect and designer was Ari Elhanani. Before immigrating to Jerusalem in 1922, Elhanani was exposed to Russian avant-garde as a student in Kiev. Perhaps as a result of this influence, he chose to exhibit Lursky's photographs of workers who embodied the fair slogan, "Building the World of Tomorrow." Similarly, the giant statue of a pioneer in the main hall aspired to the heroic, utopian, socialist ideals of the period. Indeed, the pavilion's works prominently displayed Jewish Palestinian motifs that had their origins in the Bezalel School. The three 14-foot hammered copper relief figures on the building's facade, called the Toiler of the Soil, the Laborer and the Scholar, was sculpted by Morris Ascalon, who was born in Hungary, studied in Brussels and Milan, and immigrated to Palestine in 1934. This work introduced the world to the concept of a Jewish state that mirrored the biblically inspired style of the Bezalel artists. Other features appropriated the Zionist iconography favored by the Bezalel school. The courtyard at the pavilion's entrance showed the creative genius of landscape architect J.J. Levinson, who installed 50 varieties of trees and plants from Palestine, including orange, lemon, lime, fig, and date trees. The courtyard also had one of the largest trees on the fairgrounds, a 16-foot-high date palm with a 14-foot spread. Inside the pavilion, on the center wall, was a painting on glass of the sun rising to symbolize the approaching redemption of the Holy Land and the salvation of oppressed Jewry throughout the world. To emphasize the biblical continuity of the Jewish people, a model of the Temple of Solomon was on view, as were bronze tablets with raised silver lettering. These tablets summarize the important dates in the 4,000 years of Jewish history from the time of Abraham to the present. Throughout the pavilion, Hebrew was prominently on display on a roll of Palestinian newsprint, on a calendar, on posters. By the 1920s, some of the Bitsela students began to rebel against the rigid artistic traditions the institution insisted upon. They were drawn to a more subjective art. Eretz Yisrael, Nachum Gutman, and Rubin, wanting to express their joy in the burgeoning Jewish state, opted for a colorful, naive way of painting. To a significant extent, these modern painters created a Hebrew version of post-impressionist painting using a palette of light colors and expressionist brushstrokes. In 1948, after Israel was founded, the New Horizons group came to prominence. Their leader was Yosef Zaritsky, a well-known artist and educator who believed in the freedom of individual expression. The works of these artists reflected a tremendous love for Israel's unique development and its modernism. Their passion and ideas shaped the face of Israeli art, not only in small landscapes and figurative works, but in the large-scale murals, sculptures, and monuments that were installed in public spaces. To a degree, the Israel Pavilion at Expo 67 presented a visual narrative that recalled what was seen at the Jewish Palestine Pavilion in 1939. It celebrated Israel's rebirth and growth in the wake of the Holocaust through a beautifully landscaped garden, a history of ancient Israel that included the Dead Sea Scrolls and other archaeological treasures, a display of Israel's achievements in agriculture, and panels and films that documented the country's social and cultural accomplishments. It also acknowledged the revival of Hebrew as a vibrant spoken language. However, the members of the design team, Shmuel Grundman, Paul Kaur, Dan Reisinger, and others, were determined to imbue its spaces with a colorful, modernist visual language. To attain this goal, they selected distinctly different and provocative artists who would bring a rich and lively modern aesthetic to the displays. One was Ruth Zafarty, the only woman in the New Horizons group. Zafarty is known for her sophisticated, naive sculptures and her illustrations for children's books. In her contribution, she depicted Israel's biblical history and the diversity of its people and places through panoramic scenes created using toy-like sculptures made of wood, bronze, and ceramics. Jean David was also a member of the Horizons group, recognized for his large-scale murals, posters, and graphic designs. In his surrealistic illustrations of Haifa, Jerusalem, Tel Aviv, and Tiberias, he used collage to convey a joyful appreciation of the people, architectural features, and views of each city. Igael Tamarkin, a stage designer and sculptor who rebelled against the lyrical abstraction of the Horizons group, evoked the technological inventiveness of Israel's pioneers through assembling found objects that suggested agriculture and industrial implements. The last exhibit was a tapestry that alluded to peace. The artist Shalom Moskowitz was a Hasidic Jew who had little knowledge of art history and contemporary art, yet he created works with a modernist flavor. Expo 67 marked the heyday of Israeli artists presenting works at a world's fair. From the 1960s to the present, Israeli art has evolved in numerous directions, exploring political, historical, and religious issues through experimental practices in painting, sculpture, video, performance, and installation art. Nevertheless, this proliferation has seldom been displayed at recent fairs. Furthermore, the response of pavilion designers to the various themes of success in fairs has been essentially different. Rather than tell the whole story of Israeli nationhood as the 1939 and 1967 pavilions did, they chose to emphasize only one aspect of Israel's reality, such as Israel's agricultural landscapes. Recent decades have seen increased threats to Israel's agricultural landscapes. One of the country's most pressing issues is a burgeoning population and the resulting urban sprawl, which involves the loss of farmland. This urgent problem prompted Knafel Klimor architects to come up with concepts that marry architectural planning and agricultural activities. The theme of Expo Milano 2015 was Feeding the Planet, Energy for Life. In response, Israel named its pavilion the Fields of Tomorrow. The mandate was to call attention to the country's achievements in architecture, in particular its development of drip irrigation systems that improve crop yields. The eye-catching exterior of the pavilion, which was conceived by Knafel Klimor architects, consisted of long, wide, horizontal rows of field crops that had been taken from Israel's Galilee region. It was not only a work of architecture, it was a work of living art that evoked extraordinary visual delight in the viewer in a landscape that changed over time. Outside the pavilion, a female video character appeared to interact with the host, whose responsibilities included explaining Israel's reforestation program. Once inside, visitors found themselves in an exhibition space devoted to the history of agriculture in Israel from its beginnings in Jewish Palestine to the present day. The history was presented through the lived experiences of three generations of a young woman's family. In a second room, videos show how Israel helps other nations with new technological inventions that are revolutionizing farming worldwide. According to Panofsky, the meanings we give images derive from a worldview that determines our perceptions of and interactions with the world. When it comes to the pavilion at three world's fairs between 1939 and 2015, the exhibition presented a worldview of Israeli nationhood through visual narratives that interpret the past, showcase the accomplishments of the present, and proposed a vision for a better tomorrow. Of the three pavilions, the one at Expo 67, created 19 years after the birth of the nation, was significant in its use of Israeli modern art to express Israel's uniqueness within the framework of its history, achievements, and aspirations. The pavilion at Expo Milano, on the other hand, reminded us through its use of new visual media that within a worldview, changing, challenging conditions and events can give rise to new concepts. Thank you.